Hello, gang, and a warm welcome along. It's Tuesday, the 1st of February 2016. Today's United Kingdom Talk. Thank you very, very much for those of you that were up very late last night. We did. We were testing some of the stuff last night because I've got a new camera. We've had a couple of issues with the picture going a little bit mad all of a sudden for no reason. I think we've cured that. And it was also a bit of a issue, which has actually been going on for some time, with the synchronisation between my mouth and the sound as you're watching live. Not the recorded, those of you that watch live. There was a bit of an issue with the synchronisation, which I think we've sorted out. Now, I found a setting on there last night, which it changes how the mouth moves with the sound. I cannot find it for the life of me again this morning. It's one of those things, if you're into computers or you'll know exactly what I mean, you're looking around for this setting and then you'll find it and you'll adjust something and everything will be working all right. But when you go to look for it again, you cannot find it anywhere. Am I right? It's the old tick in a box and I can't find it. So I'm hoping that it saved it from last night and that's all working with the audio secret. Actually, perhaps you'll tell me this morning. Perhaps you could send us a little message if...
find it anywhere.
Am I right? Shut up. Sorry, I'm listening to myself there. Hang on a minute. Let me just turn that off because you don't want to hear me twice. It's bad enough hearing me once, isn't it? We'll see. Ah, Dino says it's all good there. Thank you very much, Dino. So that must be working now. I think we've sorted that out, okay? Good morning to, good afternoon, rather, to Ashley. Rod Brown's with us this morning. Hello, this afternoon. Good afternoon, Rod. Elaine's there. Oh, do you like the jacket? Yeah, I think I've worn this. It looks a bit purple on the screen, doesn't it? This is actually blue. It's a dark blue, and I've worn this to one of the Barry Manilow concerts, Elaine, all right? Hello to Danny Davis, who's with us as well, and Gustav, who's with us right at the beginning there. Good morning, Gustav, or good afternoon, Gustav, to you as well, okay? Good morning to Sean Riches. Morning, Sean. He's there as well, young Sean. Now, in the papers this morning, in the Daily Mail. We're starting with the Daily Mail today, boys and girls. And it's so nice to see some old bag about to go to prison. And it says a road rage motorist is facing jail after being filmed screaming, "I'm going to knock you out." Ah, yes, but not an ordinary person. A star, boys and girls, one of the BBC's own stars, the great Jeremy Vine on BBC Radio 2, 88 to 99 FM, 91 FM. This is Radio 2 from the BBC. Yes, apparently this woman, Shanique Cyrena Pearson, 22, and she's walking. And that must be a picture. I can see a picture of her walking towards the court and she's full of it. You know the sort, full of it. You know, I'm so important. I am. One of those type of people. Anyway, she was found guilty of road rage offences after shouting abuse and threatening poor little Mr. Jeremy Vine in the row on August the 26th last year. In Kensington, dear. I know, not Hackney. Not Southall. Not Roehampton. Kensington, of all places. I know, this sort of trash walks around even in Kensington now. Can you believe that? She left the court with a jacket over her head and said, "I'm not happy." You can just imagine it. Can you imagine me doing that? Look, I'm not happy. Please don't look at me. But I don't know why people do that. They you know, like they see the camera and they're like that. You know, forgetting that the camera has already taken about 2 million pictures of you. And then suddenly they decide they don't want any more. Why do they do that? It's like these celebrities that come out with dark glasses on. Everyone knows who they are. Everyone knows that it is, you know, the untalented Victoria Beckham walking along with these dark glasses on like that. We know it's her. Why do they do that? Put the dark glasses on. It goes on. This woman was convicted at Hammersmith Magistrates Court of driving without reasonable consideration for other road users. And this is excellent. This is excellent. Apparently, the court heard she formed a weapon with her fingers, like that, you know, and cocked it at Mr. Vine's head as he pulled along her side her at a set of traffic lights, which he interpreted as a serious threat. And so you would. I wonder how you report people like that, though. You know when you see the really dangerous drivers, and my God, I see enough of those. I must see a handful of those every night. You know, generally, when I'm coming home from work, you know, I'm on the old inside lane on the motorway. Yes, I really am that sad old man going along at 55, 60 mile an hour. I'm on the inside lane, and the people that tear past, sometimes racing one behind the other. How do you report that? Can you report that? Does that work? You know, I don't know how that works. I don't know if anyone's got any sort of advice on that, or anyone who's actually done that, have you? Has anyone actually done that? Reported another driver. How would you go about doing that? And then do you have to put your name to it? I don't want them knocking at my door, dear. Hello, did you report me? Nothing to do with me. Deny all knowledge. That's the best way. Sean says, I'm going to send him to sleep. Is that right? You're watching this to send you to sleep. A lot of people watch this show because they have trouble sleeping. That's absolutely true. Just going back to the driving again. Have you seen any bad driving like that that you've reported? Or maybe you've seen it. Then you can call in and tell me this afternoon if you want to. I've got a local London phone number. It's 020-8144-3477. That's my local London number, OK? 020-8144-3477. Lines are open. Or if you've got Skype, you can Skype in as well. My Skype username is United Kingdom Talk. All one word, United Kingdom Talk for the Skype, or the phone number 020-8144-3477. Dino is going to see Whoopi Goldberg next week. Oh, that is fantastic. I used to love her on Star Trek, The Next Generation, and of course The Nuns. I will follow him. I will go where he will go. Oh, what a lovely song. You know, at that point, had I had a lot of money with me, I would arrange a choir of people to come in. I would absolutely arrange a choir of people to come in and start singing for you or live on the show. Yes, a choir from the local school, something like that. On the line is Danny Davis. Have you moved back to North Wales in Wrexham, Danny?
I have.
You're there now, are you? Excellent.
I am, yes. Unpacked and everything's hunky-dory.
Good, good, good. I was actually looking at the map the other day, Danny. Danny's got a new job. Have you started your new job yet?
No, not yet. They've put it back for a few weeks because the store doesn't open till March.
Oh, they're not ready yet. No, has the building overrun a bit, has it?
Yeah, so I'm temporarily working in a pub.
Oh, OK. Oh, well, that's fair enough. But I looked at Wrexham the other day and it's not where I thought it would be. You're right at the very top of Wales, aren't you?
Yeah, it's right next door to Chester. So when you said your Auntie Brenda lived in Nantwich, that's probably a half an hour's drive, three quarters of an hour's drive from Wrexham.
Oh, right. Yeah, I was talking to her about that the other day. She actually, when she was married, she's always been married, but when her husband was alive, they had two places. There was that was like the main place, and they had a little place in Tring. And I think they always intended to sell the place up north and move to Tring, which is all very well when you're with someone because it's a very, very quiet place. Unfortunately, shortly after that, he died and she elected to sell the place up north, which she did. Now, where that place was, you would see people walking past. You know, it was sort of a reasonably... Yeah. It wasn't busy like London or Cardiff, somewhere like that. It wasn't busy. But nevertheless, there were people walking past all the time. When she moved to Tring, no one walks past. And her bungalow is kind of set back from the road. And she doesn't see anyone, you know, and she's on her own. And it must be just dreadful. I mean, this won't happen to me because I've never had like a very long-term relationship. I think the most has been about 2 years. So in a way, I think I'm better off sometimes because I will never experience the loneliness of someone who's been together with someone for like 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years, will I?
Well, it's like a mother as well. You, when your mother's gone, you kind of suffer that kind of same thing as well, don't you?
Yes. Yeah, but not if you're not living with them. You know, I never forget my mum. Never. She's in my head all the time. But I wasn't living with her in the last 20 years of her life. I wasn't living with her. if you see what I mean. Right. So I miss her. Of course I miss her every day, talk to her every night while I'm in bed and all that business. But I wasn't living with her like as a partner. Yeah. You know, and when you're with someone for so long, it must be like losing an arm or a leg or something like that, wouldn't it? What's your longest relationship, Danny?
Well, it's probably about 2 years.
What was that, a cat? A dog?
No, it was one of my ex-boyfriends.
2 years, was it?
Yeah, and the one, that's the reason why I moved to Manchester, was because of my last boyfriend. So I broke up from him and I stayed, and then obviously I got a new job, so I've had to move back.
Right.
But, you know, you kind of just get used to it after a while. You just kind of go home and, oh, they're not there anymore. So yeah. It is a bit lonely to start off with, but you kind of get used to it. So it's only been, well, September last year. So, right.
And
it's only four months.
So you moved up there for a clean break, did you?
Yeah, so it was literally...
Yes, that's how to do it. Cut off the dead wood, dear. Remove the fat. That's what I say. Absolutely, dear.
So it was just literally broke up in September. I lived there till, two weeks ago?
Yes.
And then just moved back home, got another job. Got this pub job temporarily. And then going to start in Greg's pretty soon, because I was supposed to start on Monday, just gone.
Yes, I remember you saying that. Yeah.
They phone me up and go, oh, we can't start you yet because the building work's overrun. Well,
can't you go in there and help them with the building work? I could see you carrying a few bricks. I said that with a B.
I'm not an odd carrier, I'm afraid. I'm not built like that.
how about banging some, you know, banging some wood up on the wall, or putting a few nails in, laying a few floorboards? Or maybe you can polish the windows. Double glazing? You do double glazing? What about roofing? Electrics? Anything you can do, dear?
I can do some electrics, but I'm not qualified an electrician.
No.
So
there's all sorts of laws now. I do believe, actually, I'm not allowed to actually install a socket now. I'm pretty sure of that. I don't think you can do any internal electric works anymore. Is that right? Or wouldn't you know?
I'm not too sure. I know you can take plugs off appliances and change fuses and do all that, but you can't actually physically do any, you know, say you wanted to rewire your house, you're not allowed to do that anymore.
Yeah. I remember the days when nothing came with a plug on it. I mean, everything's got like a plug attached to it now already, isn't it? Well, you used to have to buy the plug and put the plug on. And the amount of people that didn't know which wire went where was unbelievable. There must have been an awful lot of people electrocutely killed, dear. Watch out for that electricity.
You do. When I was in school, many years ago.
Yes.
I won't tell you how many. But it was, we did it in science. It's part of, they do it in your science lessons. I don't know if they still do it now, but I learned how to change a plug in physics.
Oh, right. Okay. Yeah. I don't know which, that doesn't sound like a physics type thing to me.
Because it's electricity, isn't it? So you kind of do electricity and
Do you remember in the physics class, did the teacher, what is it? Did he stand on something and then all his hair came up?
Yeah.
What was that called? Some sort of lightning machine or something like that.
Yeah, it looks like a dome, and then there's a belt that goes round it.
Right.
I can't remember what it's called.
And while he was standing there, you weren't allowed to touch him, otherwise you would die.
But you used to stand, because you used to stand in a plastic tray, and you put your hands on it, and your hair would stand on end, but nobody was allowed to go near you.
That sounds about right. Yeah, I remember that. And physics teachers are strange people, aren't they? Have you noticed that? We had two physics teachers, and they were both a little bit oddballs.
My chemistry teacher was like that. One of my chemistry teachers.
Oh, that's, chemistry was so boring. Did you like chemistry?
I did really well in my sciences.
Oh, right, yeah.
I got A stars in sciences.
Oh, and you had to learn that table. What's that called? The period table. Periodic table. Oh, my God. All those little letters. I ain't got a clue what that was. And what did it all mean? We don't know.
Helium, oxygen. It's things that make the world go round, really. Everything that's in the world is on that table.
Is it? Give me an example then. O2, obviously, oxygen. You know, without oxygen, I couldn't be here. And I don't yet class myself as an oxygen waster. I certainly don't, darling. I hope you don't either.
No, you're not. It's like helium.
Yeah.
Helium is a gas.
Right.
There's helium in the air.
Yes.
Right up in the atmosphere.
Right.
So that's and there's, you know, you've got all your argon, and then you've got your iron, you've got your gold, your silver,
yeah,
your neon, that's a gas. You see all these neon lights, that's the gas that flows through it. There's no bulb in it, it's just gas.
Okay, I've just been told people are having trouble hearing you. Oh, it's that damn button again, isn't it? There you go. Sorry, everyone. Sorry. Oh, there's a button on here. On my mixer, there's a button, right? Now, if you're watching a live show, you'll be able to hear him properly now. I'm so sorry. When that bit of music comes on at the beginning, the countdown, right? I can't hear that unless I push a fader up on here, right? Watching it as you would watch it. So I watch, there's about a 9-second delay in between when I talk and move and when you see it, right? So on my other computer, I can watch that 9-second delay bit. So then I can hear the music and know that it's working. Now, to do that, I have to unpush a button, right? Otherwise, the sound would come back through and you'd get like a double sound, if you see what I mean.
Yeah.
So if I don't push that button again, the callers can't hear you properly. Sorry, Danny, but it's okay, everyone. He didn't say anything of interest. You haven't missed anything.
Well, here's a little claim to fame quickly.
Thank you, Ray. Thank you, Gustav. Thank you, Mark. Oh, Gustav says, a Valder graph generator makes your hair stick up. Think that's what it's called. Does that ring a bell at all?
Thank you, Mark. Something like that. It was German, I think. I think it's German made, right. But, you know. But the claim to fame is my chemistry teacher was one of 8 people that invented the breathalyzer.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, I've got a story there, the breathalyzer. Oh, I'm going back here about 25 years. All right, Ray, thank you, Ray and Mark, for telling us that. Yeah, if there's something ever wrong, don't be afraid to let me know, because sometimes I don't realise. It literally is one button in front of my ear. Yes, years ago, I'm going back here 30 years, I was going out with someone. I was working at the Black Cab at the time. And I used to have a pint and a half to drink. I don't drink anymore. I used to have a pint and a half of lager, right? Anyway, so I was going out with someone. I dropped them home. And we'd had an argument. And he told me, right, I'm going to ring up the police now and tell them that you're drinking over the limit. You know, I'm like, no, you know, I'll pee off and all that business. Yeah, whatever. Anyway, so I'm driving home. As I've turned around the corner, outside my house is a police car waiting for me. Could you believe it? A police car was waiting. Oh, hello, sir. Could we have a word? Have you been drinking tonight? I said, oh, well, someone reported me. I'm sorry, sir. We're not obliged to say that. Yep, so we had the breathalyzer and I blew in this thing, which came up yellow, I think. Yellow. Does that sound right?
They don't do it in colours. They do it on... Because it's 31 milligrams.
Oh, no. There was no electronic machine, dear.
Oh.
This is how long ago that was. You just blew into this like it was like a some sort of drugs pipe. I thought they were giving me drugs, dear. With some sort of like little glass thing. And it would blow. And I think it would come up red, which was very bad. Yellow, which is okay, but on the way to being bad. Or green. And it came up yellow because I knew I could have about a pint and a half and that would be fine. And that was all right. Okay, sir, that's no problem at all. Thank you very much. We're sorry to have troubled you. And they went on their way. But he had reported me and thought I would get caught. Isn't that awful?
I take it you didn't see that person again.
No, you're having a laugh, don't you? No, I don't think so. What an awful thing to do. Try and get someone into trouble like that. So that's my... and I think, is that the only time I was ever breathalyzed? That was, I think, once. Yeah, the only time I was breathalyzed. And good. You know, I'm glad I was breathalyzed. You know, people driving under the influence of alcohol is just ridiculous. And I've seen them before. I've seen them going like that on the road, you know, twisting all over the place. Awful.
They're only going to kill themselves or other people.
Yeah. And more...
Sorry, The thing about what you were talking about earlier on about how to report people,
Yes.
just take their registration plates,
And report it to who?
and report it to the police, because the
Really?
police are able, for the database, they're able to see who owns the car, where the person lives, because it's all on your V5, isn't it? So all they'll do is they'll pull up the details of who
Right.
owns the car, go around the house
That is.
and say you're driving erratically and this, that, and the other.
I mean, it's so bad sometimes. You haven't seen half of it. When I travel in and out of London, most days of the week, not every day, fortunately, most days of the week, I'm just astounded by some of the driving that goes on in and out the traffic. And you know, the whole joke is you see them going in and out the traffic, da da da, pull in front, and then you catch them up at the lights anyway. What is the point?
I know, they're ridiculous
And
drivers.
you know that the more relaxed you are at driving, you know, just going along at a reasonable speed in that slow lane, the more relaxed you are, the more you see this sort of thing going on, Danny, you know. Do you drive? I can't remember. I think you said you drive, but you haven't got a car, is that right?
That's right, yeah. I do have a license.
Right.
It's 10 years this year since I've had my license,
Is it
so.
really? And you haven't got a car yet, though? What would you
Well,
like?
I've had a few cars, but obviously because of when I was living in Manchester before I moved
Don't
to
need it,
Manchester,
do
I
you?
just I, yeah, because
No,
the bus
same as
was
London.
cheaper.
Yeah, same as London. Would it help if you had one in Wrexham, or can you walk to work
Yeah,
from there, or what?
I'm going to get a car within the next 3 or 4 weeks. Yeah,
Okay.
because it'll be easier for my job. Because of the early starts and possibly this, that, and the other. So I'm going to get one because then, obviously, because I've got friends in Manchester now,
Yes.
I could, and I've got obviously friends here. So if I had a car, I could just spontaneously just go, right, I'll come over for the evening. Well, and I'll book a hotel or whatever, and I'll come stay at yours and we'll have a few drinks. So whereas now I have to like plan. I'll get the train, and then I've got to get a train from the city. I've got to get a tram from the city centre, or I've got to walk. But and then you've got to make sure they're in at the same time. So if you're in a car, you can just kind of just turn up really and just knock on the door.
Yes,
So
okay, cool. All right, then. Well, thanks for calling in. Nice to talk to you as
thank you.
always, Danny.
Take care,
It
Chris. Nice
starts
speaking
off
to you
the old
soon.
calls rolling. Bye bye, Danny. All right,
Bye
Danny.
bye.
Bye bye now. Oh, yeah, nice to talk to him. As I say, sorry about not pushing that button again. John says it keeps buffering for him. Yeah, it's difficult to tell sometimes. It's usually you, to be honest. The other person, you know, other people would be telling me if it was buffering, if it was a problem this end. Okay, Ray Reynolds said, "Push that button now, Marty Kane." Oh yes, Ray, Marty Kane from New Faces. You're a star, you're a star. You've a big, great face and a lovely bra. I can't remember the exact words, but I love that. New Faces. And do you remember the scoreboard on that Spaghetti Junction? Oh wow. Wouldn't it be fabulous, Ray, to have a Spaghetti Junction type board on the stage at Central Station behind us all, so that when people clap, certain amount of lights come up? I mean, how many bulbs? I think we could have like 1,000 bulbs for each person, something like that. And you might actually light out one or two of those. You might, Ray. All right. Hello to Adam. I hope your back's a little bit better today, Adam. Hello to Ross, who's. Oh, hang on, you're having a conversation with someone else, aren't you, on there? Sorry. Sorry, you're having a conversation with someone else there. Now, you remember we were talking yesterday about Doctor Who. Doctor Who has resigned. Well, the plot thickens. Could this be the ageism at the BBC again? Don't forget that phone line's open if you want to call in. 020-8144-3477 is your number. Incidentally, those of you that sent me your addresses, what we were talking about on yesterday's show, I think I've got all of those. Don't worry. If you visit Central Station, then I will bring them to you in the pub, those things that we were talking about yesterday. If you don't know what you were talking about yesterday, then you're clearly not a regular viewer or listener, are you? So you won't know. And I'm not going to tell you again. I'm not going to tell you again. I might say something at the end of the show, but it's for regular viewers and listeners only. I got your messages. Thank you very much. If you come to Central Station on Friday, I'll bring your things down there. Save on the postage, all right? Now, in the Sun this morning, did the BBC force out Peter Capaldi as Doctor Who ratings slump from complex plots? Now, I said this a few years ago about the Doctor Who complex plots when the writer was changed to Stephen Moffat, who, I'm sure is a fantastic writer. But when he took over Doctor Who, the plots became so complicated, even I couldn't follow them sometimes. You'd be watching a telly and you're thinking, well, how did we get to that scene? And when I mentioned it on the show, and this is about 2 or 3 years ago now, when I mentioned it, a lot of you agreed with me. Although some people said, well, you need to sit there and watch the telly and not do anything else at the same time. Because let's be honest, we're all guilty of that, aren't we? We've got your phone next to your telly. Some of you got iPads and things there sitting on. And you watch it and you just pick up the phone and then you watch the Oh, I've missed a bit out. And you have to, I mean, obviously you can't do it if it's live, but you wind back a little bit and watch it again, don't you? But I did say those Doctor Who plots have become so complicated that I couldn't follow what was going on. Well, here's the Sun. If Sweary Spin Doctor Malcolm Tucker... Who's Sweary Spin Doctor Malcolm Tucker? Who the hell's that? Who's Malcolm Tucker? Anyone know who that is? I don't know who that... Anyway, the story. Just weeks ago, Peter Capaldi, who played Tucker to much acclaim in The Thick of It, swore allegiance to the TARDIS, telling fans he hoped to play the Doctor for a long time. He declared, I've never worked on the same job for 3 years, but now I feel is the time to move on, which he said on Monday. And I thought that was a bit odd as well. And the other thing I said yesterday on the show is that these doctors now, ever since the reboot, they didn't seem to stay for very long, do they? John Pertwee and Tom Baker, they seem to be doing that for years and years. This new lot, they only stay for 3 or 4 years. What's all that about? Anyway, the story goes on. Could a dramatic drop in ratings be the reason Capaldi, and it says in inverted commas, quit as Doctor Who? Interesting. Last night, insiders claimed the real reason for the extraordinary about face was that he jumped before he was pushed. Now, I could believe this, actually. And I've also been aware that the ratings for Doctor Who have been going down. I personally think it's the complicated plots. I think he was or is the best Doctor there's been for a long time. I really do. I do feel Doctor Who needs to be a bit of an older man rather than a young, pretty bloke going around kissing. I mean, the last one was kissing people, dear. Kissing people on Doctor Who. God's sake, man. That's not what Doctor Who is about. They said the Scottish star faced being dumped by incoming show boss Chris Chibnall, remember this is in The Sun, this is not me saying it, who has been tasked with rescuing the series, which has seen ratings nearly half. He's understood to want someone younger than 58, Capaldi, to play the hero. And there's a picture of the Moffat, Stephen Moffat there, which have been slammed for being too complex. And I said this 3 years ago. He came in and suddenly we couldn't work out what the hell was going on. I don't know what you think of Doctor Who or what you think about that story. You want to talk about it? You can call in if you want to. 020-8144-3477 is my phone number. Who was your favourite Doctor Who? For me, David Tennant, brilliant actor, very overacted part. I thought it was really overacted. And the same with the other young lad. I can't remember his name now. The good-looking one, you know, tall, thin, gorgeous. But for me, that wasn't a Doctor Who. Again, a lot of overacting in there. Ray Reynolds says, I'm not a Doctor Who fan, but I have two Daleks. Oh, I've got one. It's here, I think. Here is one of my Daleks. Exterminate. Exterminate. Do not dispute with the Daleks. You will be exterminated. Yes, there's my little Dalek there. Got a lot of dust on him there. Oh, look at the time. 10 to 1. It must be my dinner. Do you know, I still haven't sorted out the quiz for tonight yet. I've got to get that going as well. Ashley said his... Thank you, Matt Smith. Ashley's my favourite doctor was Matt Smith. And I wasn't keen on him either, really. A brilliant actor and all that. But he was just a bit too young for that particular job, I think. Gustav says, no spinning... Oh, my God. Gustav. Oh, dear. Just a moment. Just a moment. Sorry, Gustav. It's such a blooming mess in here at the moment. 1 minute. Hang on, dear. Where's that thing? There we are. That's that there. That there. There we are. Sorry about that, gang. Dreadful. Dreadful. We're doing things by halves. That actually looks... I don't know why that looks like it's going to fall off to you. Does it you? It looks kind of... But it's not. I don't think it is anyway. Is it the position of it? 1 minute. Is it the position of this? What is it doing? It looks like it's kind of on the side. Ah. Is that better? Does that look better? Because it looked like it was about to fall off, didn't it? Oh, you can't see my duck. Can you see the duck? Shall I move that? There we are. I can't get the duck in. I think the poinsettia is going to go again, Ray. I think the poinsettia is about to go, darling. It's quite damp in there. But the leaves are dropping off. It's a terrible mess in the studio here. Oh, dear, dear me. There you are, Gustav. One spinning glitter ball, one Union Jack light. The standards have been bought up again. Thank you. Thank you very much. Hello to Miss Jason, who's with us today as well. Miss Jason, we are honoured to have you as a viewer today, dear. A viewer, how marvellous. Miss Jason. All right. Let's see your comments here on Doctor Who. Any more comments on Doctor Who? No, no more comments. All right. Ray says, I remember Peter Capaldi was not a popular choice, but I'm sure he is a fine actor. I thought he was a really good Doctor Who, to be honest, Ray. I really did. I thought it was one of the better ones anyway. 020-8144-3477 is my phone number. Good morning to Adam, who says, hello, I'm watching you. I'm in A&E. The back's got worse. Oh, you're in A&E. Could you turn it up so everyone can hear us? Okay? We're desperate for viewers here, dear. Desperate. Only 9 million today. Very, very disappointing. And the mirror ball, and you've just told us the mirror ball, and that is back on there. So thank you very much, Adam. I hope you do all right there in A&E this afternoon. Ross is calling in from Norwich, home of Anglia Television. Da, 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 da. Where is that horse?
This is Ross Patsalt with United Kingdom Talk Travel. There are hold-ups on the southbound M62 this afternoon, heading towards Bracknell, due to a man in a Union Jack jacket. Oh. Meanwhile, heading towards Reading, there are long tailbacks as Sean Ritchie's milk float has broken down. Just having a look at the speed monitors and everywhere else seems okay. Trains going out of Liverpool Street Station in London are going to be 10 hours late today because someone has done a big poo in the loos again, and all other services in and out of Berkshire are looking good. If you have anything to report, call the United Kingdom Talk Jam line, hands-free, on 020-8144-3477. More in 30 minutes.
That's a very, very professional voice, Ross Patsalt. Oh, it's gone. It's gone. It was... Some people are on another planet completely. So there we are, traffic news and everything like that. How marvellous. Thank you very much, Ross Patsalt, for your insert, for your segment, as the Americans would call it, a segment, you see, for your inserted segment into this programme today with local traffic news and information about block toilets. And the reason it's a block toilet, I think, is because poor old Adam the plumber is in hospital with a bad back. Terrible news, terrible news. Now, if you're going on one of those dates, do you have a little Grindr app or something like that? Are you on Tinder? Or there's Craigslist. I don't know what Craigslist is. Does anyone know what Craigslist is? I've never really heard of this, Craigslist. Anyway, so watch out. Watch out, boys and girls, because here it is. A Washington woman in the US, and we have millions of viewers in America. Millions of viewers in America are tuning in to hear what we've got to say, darling. Yes. Mummy Teresa was only over there a few days ago holding hands with Donald. Oh, God knows what he tried to do to her. Oh, my Lord. Anyway, a Washington woman is accused, you wait till you hear this, of trying to murder a date she met on Craigslist before trying to eat his heart. Oh, God's sake. Always go out with a vegetarian, dear. That's what I said. Always go out with either a vegetarian or even better, a vegan. They're not going to eat you, lovey. They're not going to eat you. The 24-year-old has arranged to eat... The 24-year-old had arranged to meet her alleged victim at the Rodeo Inn Motel room in Linwood, Washington. But it quickly became apparent that romance wasn't on the cards. I don't know what Craigslist is. Hang on, let me have a look what it is. Is it all one? Or Craigslist? There we are. Let's have a look. Craigslist provides local classifieds and forums for jobs, housing, for sale, personals. Oh, okay, so it's got personals and all that in it. All right, fair enough. After repeatedly asking if the man, who was 29, was a murderer, was a murderer, she took out her own pocket knife, police reported. Well, I'm a serial killer, she reportedly announced. The woman, whose identity has not yet been released, proceeded to slash and stab her date several times as he tried to escape, according to the news station Como. Como? Como. That don't sound right, does it, for a news station? Como. K-O-M-O. This is K-O-M-O, Washington. Because they've all got letters, haven't they, there? Maybe we should rename this program from United Kingdom to UKT. No, it doesn't sound very good, does it? UKT. K-O-M-O. You're listening to K-O-M-O. 92.5 Washington, D.C. Which would then be... That would be followed then by about 3 hours worth of adverts and then maybe one song. Yeah. The injured 29-year-old who insists he met the woman on a website for dating, not just sex, was eventually able to flee and call police from the motel office. He was taken to a medical centre with serious injuries, including a punctured lung. However, he expected to recover. His attacker was found by police in the parking lot with the knife still in her pocket. Silly cow. Dump it, dear. Dump it. They haven't got any idea how to murder these people, have they? When they confronted her, they said she confessed she had planned to eat her date's heart. What, while it was still beating? Oh, that's not nice, is it? She had even written a note that she planned to leave on his body, saying would kill again, officers said. The loon, she's eventually allegedly told interviewing officers. I'm a loon, that's what she said to them. I'm a loon. Well, so am I. But I don't go around eating people's hearts, do I? How awful. Have you heard of a bad date? We'll talk about it another time, bad dates. We'll have a call in about that. Have you ever had a bad date? We'll do a show on that, all right? In a few shows' time. Ashley says, Craigslist is an American-based company with classified ads of all kinds. Adam says, everyone share this broadcast. Sorry, the diazepam is kicking in. May have to watch this later on, which is done in capitals. What's diazepam? Is that a pain relief thing? Isn't that a sleeping thing? I don't know. I don't really know. I don't really take any pills unless the doctor gives them to me. And I do have pills that I take every morning and every night and things like that. But I don't self-medicate. Paracetamol, I don't do any of that really. I mean, I had bad feet for a couple of years and I was supposed to have, the doctor said to have, the pain one, is it paracetamol? Something beginning with P. Can't remember what it was called now. And I used to shove this. Oh, no. Ibuprofen. That was it. I used to shove this down my throat. Wasn't doing it. Didn't do anything. And then they say, oh, you've got to give it a chance to get into your system. Well, I mean, it'd about 3 or 4 days. Nothing was happening. So I gave up with those. I don't think half of these tablets do anything, you know. I really don't think half of these tablets do anything. In fact, there's another tablet story in today's Daily Mail. Are you getting enough nutrients? It says the use of the, you know, the vitamin tablets, has become more and more popular in recent years. The rise in taking supplements has been met with such controversy that there is plenty of research to suggest that you can get everything you need from eating a balanced diet. And I've always said that. You know, you don't need to be shoving these blooming vitamin pills down your throat. I don't believe having a vitamin pill can be anywhere near as good as having a balanced diet. How can you just replace all that food with some chemicals and a pill? It don't make sense to me. It says, but how many of us actually achieve a balanced diet? That's the thing. This bloke, who's nutritionist at Healthspan, discusses which questions we should ask to determine if we need to be popping these pills or not. And it says, are you pregnant? rather not answer that question. it looks like it at the moment, dear. It says the Department of Health currently recommends that women who are thinking of getting pregnant should take folic acid supplement. But yeah, I don't go a lot. Are you a vegan? Now, this is interesting. Are you a vegan? Veganism has increased by 350% over the last decade. Now, just in case you don't know, vegans don't eat anything to do with animals. I'm a vegetarian, so I still have cheese. Honey comes from bees. Honey. I do try. I've knocked the milk on the head. I'm drinking soya milk now, so I'm trying to get rid of the dairy as well now, because the dairy industry isn't nice either. You know, a cow gets delivers these little babies and they're taken away from her. I've seen videos of the cow mooing because they can't find her babies. It's all very sad. It's really awful. So I'm not really a dairy person, but I have honey, and I don't know what else to do with animals I have, really. Animal kind of products, I suppose. A vegan won't have any of that. They have nothing to do with animals whatsoever. Nothing. If it comes out of an animal or is made by an animal, they don't have it. If you're a vegan, it says, if done correctly, then this diet can be healthy. But if not well planned, it can present itself with low intakes of certain nutrients. Many of these can be addressed by improving the diet, but vegans may still benefit from a multivitamin. Oh, okay. Are you over 50? Hello? Yeah, there's everyone on here, isn't it? Near enough. Birthday next week, dear. 54 next week. I'm 54 next week. Actually, I got today a letter from my pension people. My pension is set to start at 55. Yes, I cannot believe nearly this time next year I can start getting a private pension. How weird is that? I know it doesn't look it, does it? I know that. It says, as your age, dietary intake can decrease, and often the need for certain nutrients can increase as you age. Women in particular experience up to 10% bone loss during the menopause, and may benefit from calcium and vitamin D supplements there. So that's the thing. Do you have teenage daughters anyway? Anyone got a teenage daughter? Oh, that would drive me mad. Oh, the screaming and the shouting that they do, dear. Honestly, teenage girls in particular have been shown to have low intakes of key minerals. So they may need supplements. Are you a man thinking about becoming a dad? Lifestyle factors such as smoking and drinking can seriously impact your male fertility. Vitamin C and maybe zinc for you. Do you eat oily fish twice a week? No, I don't. Oh, I can't think of anything more disgusting than eating fish, especially sushi, which is full of microbeads, bits of plastic in sushi. No, you don't want any of that, dear. Go down and have some chips. Stop mucking about with that nasty fish stuff. Oily fish contains essential omega-3 fatty acids that must be obtained from the diet. These fats have been shown to help promote good heart health. No, mine's still going. And reduce inflammation in the body. If you do not eat oily fish, then you may want to consider a supplement. Have you been on antibiotics? That can do you in. You might need some supplements after that. Do you eat seven. Do you eat 7 pieces of fruit or vegetable a day? No way, I don't. No. Honestly, I don't. Many of us fail to meet the 5 a day from the NHS, and the gap has widened in light of the research suggesting that we actually need around 7 bits of fruit and veg a day. A multivitamin and mineral can act as a safety. You see, I don't go along with it. I really don't. I don't see how a pill can replace carrots and peas and bananas and things like that. I really don't. I don't. We'll finish off with this one. Do you eat a diet? Are you ready for this? With lots of processed foods. There you are. Go on, you're in that McDonald's all the time, aren't you? Eh? If the answer's yes, then your diet isn't getting what it needs from your foods. You may benefit from a good multivitamin and mineral, okay? There is some more to that. I've just read out a few bits of that one, and that's in today's Daily Mail if you want to have a little look at that, boys and girls, okay? Righto, we're due today's birthdays. Let's just do your last lot of messages coming through there, boys and girls. Ray Reynolds says, have you changed your Barry Manilow calendar to February? Thank you, Ray. Let's do it now. Barry Manilow, February picture. Here he comes. Here he comes. Da, 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 da. There he is. Oh, that won't. I can't get that over the nail. One minute. Why won't I go over there? Oh, I'll have to stick it up with a bit of tape. We need a bit of tape. Just a moment, please. Got up a little bit of tape up there. Now, I hope you can't see that. I can't be having people seeing tape on here. Right? There we are. Put that there. Like that. There we are. The Barry Manilow. Oh, Christ, it won't go over then. And there we go. The Barry. That's going to fall down. Oh, take it off. I know what I can do. If I fold it, I'll fold it over and. That's better. Will that work? Yes. Thank you. There we are, the Barry Manilow February picture. There is our Barry, 72 years old he is. Look, I hope I look like that at 72. Well, maybe not, I don't know. I don't think I'll have all that hair. Thank you, Barry. Thank you, Ray Reynolds, for correcting me. We do like a bit of correction. Yes, indeed. Hello to Sharon Stone, who's with us this afternoon. Hello to Paul Gallagher. Hello, Paul, who says vitamin D is very good for you. Is that for bones? I think vitamin D is for bones and that sort of thing. Righty-o. OK, we'll finish off today's birthdays this evening, this afternoon, boys and girls. The birthday's coming up now. Happy birthday today to John Springate, who is 68 years old today. Happy birthday, John. John, you will have seen on Top of the Pops years ago, he was in the Glitter Band. That's not Gary Glitter. Different thing altogether, OK? He was in the Glitter Band who backed Gary. All right, but and they used to play on Top of the Pops and all that, guitars and great big white jackets with big collars. Happy birthday today to John Springate, my very good friend, who I've worked with, not recently, but several times. He's a lovely, lovely man. He's only little. He's even smaller than me, dear. First time I met him, I tripped over him. God knows how he managed to jump up onto that big stage at Top of the Pops. Happy birthday, John. All right. Happy birthday today to Peter King. Happy birthday, Peter. To Gordon Flynn. To Les Muir, who's 46 years old today. To Anastacia Beaverhausen, who's 35 today. To Moses, our very good friend Moses, who is one of the doormen at the Two Brewers in Clapham, where I work on Thursday night. He's a lovely man, Moses. Happy birthday, Moses. A fellow Catholic as well, I'm pleased to say. Happy birthday, Moses. Chris Smith, it's Chris Smith's birthday today. Luke Holden, we've got a lot today. Luke Holden is 26 years old today. Stephen Banks is 28 years old today. It's all the 20s today. Michelle B. Williams is 42 years old today. Happy birthday, Michelle. And Amy Arts is 42 as well today. I'll come to the phone in a second. If you just hold on there a second, all right? And let's sing happy birthday to those wonderful people first. Sing along, gang. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Enjoy your birthdays, boys and girls. Have a lovely day. And back on the phone. It's Ross Pats Out, back on the phone. Hello, Ross.
This programme is sponsored by Sean Ritchie's Milk Floats. with great milk, orange juice and fresh bread. Find out more at seansmilkfloats.co.uk.
Have you had any? He's gone again. I love those calls that he does. That's Ross Patzell in Norwich. He's a lovely bloke, he is. He really is a nutter. He's worse than me. Worse than me. Hello to Alan Russell, who was with us as well this afternoon. Just some messages from yesterday's show, boys and girls, that I need to read out. I'll go back to that. 1 second. There we are. That's that one there. That one there. Joanna, hello Joanna, who says you can take, because we were talking about how do you get your jeans adjusted. My jeans are a terrible fit and they need to be adjusted. Joanna says you can take your jeans to a seamstress and have them made relatively inexpensive. So I might do that. I might take the trousers, because I had trousers and I was at a funeral yesterday, my dear old Uncle Terry's funeral yesterday, and the trousers fitted. Are they the only trousers? In fact, I might wear them, Ray, on Friday. Oh, you're not coming Friday, are you? I might wear them tonight, actually, and say to people, do you think these fit better than the jeans? And I think they're going to say yes. We might just have to move the trousers. It might be jeans. But I was asking yesterday whether you, if I could take the trousers and say, well, these fit me perfectly. Can you make these jeans like that? And whether she does something to them, I don't know how it works. Joanna says take them to a seamstress. So I might try that. Kiki Dee had a dream of me yesterday. Kiki Dee says, I dreamt I visited you last night and someone stole my bag. You chased them, but they got away. Oh, they must have been very fast runners, but they didn't get my keys. Then we were sitting round your kitchen table with Ray Reynolds and all my teeth started falling out. I wonder what that means. Oh, well, you're lucky. You got one over on Ray because he's already fallen out. Thank you very much for watching and listening. It's been a pleasure talking to you, as always, boys and girls. I do now try and do the shows live. They're not always going to be like an hour long, but I do try and do the shows live. I find, I feel much more of a spark going on, knowing that you're there at the same time as me. Of course, the show also goes up as a recording later on, but I do like doing them live, even though it's a little bit more effort in here. Okay, so it's a pleasure to talk to you live. Tonight, it's Wednesday night, so I'll be hosting the quiz night this evening at the King's Head Theatre Bar. That's in Upper Street, Islington. Starts at 8:30, finishes at 10:30. There's four rounds, two lots of questions, a music round and a picture round. Tonight's music round, incidentally, is Motown. Okay, tonight's music round is Motown. Alan, I think you were coming tonight. You're bringing your laptop and hard drive in tonight for me to look at, aren't you? So I'm going to sort that out for you. I might actually be able to do it in the pub. I don't need to rush away afterwards, so we might be able to do that there, and then fingers crossed, OK? So that's the quiz night tonight and every Wednesday at the King's Head Theatre Bar in Upper Street, Islington, starting at 8:30. Get there about 8 o'clock if you want a table, unless you want to book ahead for one. You can ring ahead. They save you a table with however many people, and then you just turn up within 10 minutes of your time. So if you save it for 8 o'clock, you've got to be there by 10 past 8 because it gets so busy that they have to let the table go, all right? Tonight and every Wednesday, quiz night at the King's Head Theatre Bar, hosted by yours truly, Upper Street, Islington. Apart from that, have a lovely Wednesday. Thank you very much for watching and listening to the show today, and I'll see you again very soon. Bye-bye now.